Macmillan Audio presents Parakeet by Marie-Helene Bertino. Read for you by Angela Dawe. What is the Internet? 1 week before my wedding day, upon returning to my hotel room with a tube of borrowed toothpaste, I find a small bird waiting inside the area called the antechamber, and know within moments it is my grandmother. I recognize the glittering, hematite eyes, the expression of cunning disapproval. The odor of a gym at close of day encircles her. "What is the Internet?" the bird says, does not say. Her head is the color of warning, sharp curve, yield yellow. The eyes on either side of the Cro-Magnon crown are lined the way hers were in shoddy cornflower pencil, as if to say, really look here. Her hair, that had throughout her life hurled silvery messages skyward, has been replaced by orderly navy stripes that emanate down her pate like ripples in silk. Under the beak where her unpronounced chin would have been, four regal feathers pose, each marked by an ebony dot. She hovers inches above the sofa's back, chastened and restless by her new form. The toothpaste lands with a dull thud on the carpet. I'm silent when stunned. No getting me to talk. "What is the Internet?" my grandmother the bird insists, speaking as if we are in the middle of a conversation, which, in a way, we are. She had called to ask this question 10 years before. At the time, I considered explaining the technological phenomenon, but she was so old. What would be the point, I reasoned, of telling her about the show priming to begin after her exit? There have been many times in my life when, encountering an opportunity to do good, for reasons of shyness or shock, an unwillingness to leave a safe perch has made me balk. I told my grandmother the Internet was solely for engineers and that its effect on society would be nominal. The following day, she climbed a ladder poised against her house, meaning to hammer a warped shingle. Something like a phone call, we were never certain, summoned her. She misremembered the ladder, fell from the roof, and lay unconscious until a neighbor found her. For a month, we attempted to will her out of a coma with the music of Lawrence Welk. She preferred to stay asleep. After she was gone, every room was a nothing room. I don't regret letting others rush forward to care for strangers in need. I don't regret calling my brother a little shit on his wedding day. However, lying to my grandmother about the Internet placed a painful pebble at the bottom of my stomach that would not go away. Now, my second chance claws the rim of a water glass in present internet-rich day, as alive as the rest of us, trying to sip through her beak and failing. "It turned out to be more influential than I led you to believe," I say. "No shit." Tasked with explaining it, I realize how little I know about the Internet. "It began as numbers on a screen. I make a blurping sound to signify dial-up, and explained that it grew from a device only a few people had to Wi-Fi, which I think is in the air. I gesture to indicate exploding. Network names showcase a defining feature of the user. Biscotti worshiper, sad oboe girl. People use it to promote themselves like brands." This is deep and rich information. My cheeks heat. I'm proud of myself. I extrapolate. "Because everyone is famous, no one is." I deepen, reverse. "Which is, like everything else, a good and bad thing." I say link, blog, router, spam. Even as a bird, my grandmother's dubiousness is unmistakable, the cocked avian focus doubting me. When she was alive, she preferred staying in her slippers all day and the term shove it up your ass to anything, maybe even to my grandfather, who over time became a scudding, booted shadow in the house's secondary rooms, in the garage winding a clock, in the spare bedroom repairing an outlet. Shove the clock, shove the outlet. If my grandmother ever regretted slicing into another's feelings like fondant, she never admitted it. Any room containing her was merry. This was a big deal for me, since most of my childhood felt panicked and serious. She'd listen and move her eyebrows in a way that corrected my perspective. With a gaze, she could lift me older. Offended on behalf of the product I've just begun to understand, I sell. There's almost no living being you can't connect with. At no living being, I think of her, legs tucked into her plumage, sitting above the cushions. How does it feel to be connected to every living thing? Sad, I admit. And she says, sad. When you can see anyone at any hour, it collapses perspective and time. Add to that the isolation and distance from which most people observe, and the internet gives the impression that one person is simultaneously having a party, turning 50, scuba diving, baking with a great aunt. Sounds like a giant panic attack. That's not technology's fault, I say. The internet is indifferent. It's the people who ruin it, posting only highlights, like every night is Saturday night, but most of life is Wednesday afternoon, and no one thinks that's meaningful. They omit loneliness and tedium. The people who do post honestly are considered whiners. The bird huffs, nods. No one should bother anyone else with their problems. This had been a phrase she used in life, and one of the fueling philosophies of our family. What a waste of time. It is, but there are beautiful aspects to it. I press a few buttons on my phone to conjure a picture. Goody, she says. A wall. The Great Wall of China, I correct her. Everyone can visit faraway places, kind of. It's a grand leveler in terms of class. If you can afford a phone, I guess. I change the screen option and a grid of photographs appears. People have their own page on their preferred platform. I scroll so she can see. A frosted cake. Dog on a forest path. Woman smiling over macaroni. Page of a book. Pulled taffy. Boy must from a nap. Lit pool. Selfie of a woman balancing a cat on either shoulder. A dog eats Cheez-Its off pink linoleum. A sign, do not shelve items in aisle 3 without asking Joanna. Bunting in a desert town. Aproned gelato server hovering over delicate pastel vats. A good way to connect with what are called friends, I say. Not regular friends. Usually it's like the guy who plays softball with your coworker. Who wants to be more connected? The bird says, does not say. Everyone is friends now? I think people dislike other people at the ratio did before you. We're not going to get very far if you can't say died. It's called virtual. I frown. I'm not describing this correctly. You're describing it fine. How would you know? I say, at the same time as she says. But how would I know? I've come a week early to this inn on the shaft of Long Island to prepare for the transition from woman to wife, to do what the groom calls decompress because, of late, I've become a bit of a nightmare. To break apart if necessary, but to do so properly, amid slatted pool chairs and conference coffee. I'm 36, ethnically ambiguous, and hold an intense job I do not like, biographer of people with traumatic brain injury. I present their lives in court, using storyboards and dioramas. Everyone is thrilled I'm getting married. No one can believe I found such a sweet man. Everyone adores the treats sold in this town that are hybrids of bagels and flatbread. Flagels. The inn's website boasts a recent remodel, yet the old design has only been reinforced with fresh paint, so it looks newly out of date. Above the mud-colored carpets, wallpaper vines strangle the walls, here and there resulting in a salmon-colored tulip. There are fleets of staircases and elevators and floors large enough to simultaneously host several cathartic events. In another banquet hall, another wedding will run alongside ours. The plural of catharsis is catharses. The turnover is quick. Already, a lobby poster welcomes attendees of the following week's conference that seems to be about technology and clouds. The inn is buckled to a famous lake that features prominently on the town's signage. None of my people are from this area, so the lake is not famous to us. It is akin to pointing to an actor and saying, "That's so-and-so," from a show we've never watched. A gazebo sits in an exaltation of cattails, a ruffle of trash by the edge of one of the lake's many inlets. I prefer the ocean because it is ugly and secretive and moody and can growl. Mind you, I'm awful and rarely satisfied. So far, my relaxation has manifested in inventing needs so I can have lingering conversations with the staff. I was finishing the place cards earlier when I thought, toothpaste, and wandered downstairs to inquire about the photograph taped to the concierge's computer screen. "I'm not sure if you're aware what day you've landed on." I speak to the bird in the grated voice you employ for a guest who's arrived too early. "It's Sunday. I'm getting married in 6 days. I gesture to the migration of folded cards that cover the carpet in ecru V's, anointed with all I can recall from high school calligraphy. "I have a work appointment tomorrow, a meeting with the florist, then I host our families for the groom's dinner. Mom, stepfather, friends arrive later this week, etc. Have you come to wish me well?" I say, but knowing her, my tone contains no hope. "Of course I know you're getting married." The edges of her projection spit and haw. "Do you think I'm here to ask about wires in a box?" She goes transparent, and her skeleton shows blinding bright. Then whatever debatably divine force is conjuring her regains composure, and she is opaque again. "There's something I want you to do." A rap on the door startles me and the bird, who flips from the glass to the table like traveling from one thought to the next. Through the peephole, I see a bellboy standing above a rolling table holding a metal-covered plate.
"Ma'am?"
"I didn't order anything," I say. Several feet behind him, the elevator dings. He says,
"It's a surprise."
My grandmother warbles.
"Surprise!"
He is faux cheerful. I open the door. He glides in, activates the brakes on each table leg, flips the plate's cover to reveal a cake that says, "Congratulations," bats a napkin he pulls from an unseen compartment against the air, then folds it into a triangle. His expression grows concerned, echoing mine. I have what people call an out loud face, one that others mimic without realizing. It may be the generous peat-colored eyebrows or the phrase they make with my conversation piece nose. Strangers ask, "Are you confused?" or comment, "You're having fun." What they mean is, I'm less good than others at hiding. The bellboy follows my gaze to the grandmother, now roosted on the pillow, and shrieks, drops the napkin.
"A bird!"
He heads to the door.
"I'll get the manager."
"No need to call anyone," I say. "It's handled."
"I hate birds,"
he says.
"Like, really hate."
My grandmother's feathers shiver with laughter. "She's very small," I bargain.
"Doesn't matter,"
he says.
"Small, big, hate them and always have."
My grandmother flies across the room and clings to the frame of a painting with one mirthful claw. This enjoyment of other people's discomfort was true in life. She is at once holy grandmother and holy bird as she produces a multi-garble that sounds like bland women kvetching, louder, then louder.
"Oh God,"
he says.
"What's it doing?"
His fear is so antic it must be a put-on. He cowers in a crescent shape against the wall.
"Tack, tack,"
my grandmother threatens cheerfully.
"I'm calling the concierge,"
he whispers. "Stop," I tell her. Then to him, "We don't need the concierge. This is my bird. We were talking."
"My,"
he says.
"Talking?"
"Birds talk," I say. My grandmother seems to chit-chat with herself, then produces a showy, wooden,
Hello.
I imagine the room from his perspective. Bride talking to bird. He looks like a kid who muscles through situations in which women want him to leave with what he thinks is charm, but he's probably never met women like us. Critical, exuding a very taken vibe. Hawkish, on certain evenings, literally. Even in bird form, my grandmother is all of these things. You can tell by the way she's needling him with gleeful, haughty eyes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.